nice sunny lovely afternoon. This is an event co-sponsored by the Civic and Moral Education Initiative and the Carr Centre for Human Rights Policy. I am the moderator. My name is Helen Haste. I am a visiting professor here at the Ed School. And our three speakers, two very distinguished speakers, I will introduce shortly. But the title of this event is Teaching for Social Transformation, Approaches to Human Rights Education in India, Lebanon, and Turkey. So it's a truly international event. The presenters will be exploring critically the empowerment model of human rights education, both conceptually and in practice, with examples from both formal and informal learning sectors in the three countries, India, Lebanon, and Turkey. These examples are used to investigate program variations and evidence of outcomes within these national contexts. So it's one of those events where we'll be hearing some very interesting new material from probably many of us haven't probably thought about, but in the context, which is the larger question of how we approach issues like empowerment and civic education more broadly. I'm sure the examples we're giving will in fact relate very widely to other universal issues, as well as specifically the concerns of the countries you're studying. So I'll introduce the three speakers. Felicia Tibbetts, who is the coordinator of the event. Felicia is co-founder and co-director of Human Rights Education Associates, and she's also engaged in adjunct lecturer at HGSE and the UN University of Peace, where she teaches courses on human rights education. She was a fellow at the Carr Centre for Human Rights Policy at the Harvard Kennedy School of Government during the 2008-09 year, and is currently co-teaching a course, Tools for Human Rights Practitioners, with the Carr Centre Director, Charlie Clements. Felicia Tibbetts has provided technical assistance or served as an author in curricular development efforts in Albania, Croatia, El Salvador, Estonia, Gaza, Kosovo, Northern Ireland, Morocco, Romania, Ukraine, and the US. She's very impressive. She's carried out trainings in over 20 countries and teaches on topics such as monitoring children's rights and the rights-based approach to programming. She's also worked for the Ford Foundation, Amnesty International, and a range of UN agencies as an evaluator. She worked in 2007 on a UN capacity-building program for African Union peacekeepers in Darfur, and she's currently engaged in global evaluations of UNICEF's efforts in life skills education. As well as that extremely impressive list of activities, she's also published numerous articles, manuals, and book chapters in the area of human rights education. And she's a consultative expert for the Office of the UN High Commission for Human Rights, UNICEF, UNESCO, OSCE, the Council of Europe, the Organization of American States, and the Open Society Institute. So we're very pleased indeed to have Felicia as one of our speakers today. We're honored to be. The other two speakers are equally distinguished. Zina Zagaria is the Gregorin G. Turney Fellow at the Harvard Kennedy School's Carr Center for Human Rights Policy. Her scholarly interests converge at the intersection of human rights and education policy within conflict, post-war, and development contexts, particularly in the Middle East. She has over 15 years of experience in educational development, practice, and research amongst elite and minoritized populations in the Middle East, including 10 years of education leadership, institution building, and teacher training in post-war Lebanon. She comes to the Carr Center this year, from Columbia University, where she served as lecturer at Teachers College. Her most recent publications focused on the interplay of language policy, collective identity, and human security in schools during and after violent political conflict in Lebanon. Is currently investigating how non-state armed actors engage in anti-oppression, peace, and human rights education as part of a larger interest in how to develop learning institutions whose policies, curriculum, and structure are conceptualized holistically around furthering human rights. At the Carr Center, she will extend a large-scale study of schooling to understand how varying conceptualizations of human rights are being implemented across different religious, socioeconomic and geographical contexts in Lebanon. She holds a doctorate from Columbia University Teacher College and a master's in education from here and a BA from Yale. So we're very pleased to welcome you. And thirdly, Manisha Bajaj is an assistant professor of international and private education at Teachers College, Her research and teaching interests focus on education as a force for social transformation in the Global South. She's the editor of Encyclopedia of Peace Education 2008 and the author of a Spanish language teacher training manual on human rights education, published by UNESCO, and a forthcoming book entitled Schooling for Social Change, The Rise and Impact of Human Rights Education in India, as well as numerous articles. Dr. Bajaj has also developed a curriculum particularly related to the incorporation of peace education, human rights, and sustainable development for non-profit education service providers in New York City and intergovernmental organizations such as UNICEF. So as you see, we have an extremely distinguished panel who are distinguished not only in their research, but also in their practice. So we'll be having an extremely interesting and insightful afternoon hearing about this very rich field. Welcome.
Shall I start? Thank you for that lovely introduction, and thanks for serving as our distinguished moderator today, Helen. I'm going to, against my better instincts, I'm going to read in the interest of time, but I'll hopefully be able to engage with you a bit more extemporaneously. I want to cover a lot of material, which is always a challenge in 15 minutes. Over the past four decades, human rights education has become a greater part of international discussions of educational policy, national textbook reform, and the work of non-governmental organizations. While scholars and practitioners have noted the rise in educational strategies as part of a larger human rights efforts and the emergence of HRE, what we abbreviatedly refer to human rights education as, on its own as a field of scholarship and practice, there appear to be diverse perspectives on what exactly human rights education is and what it does, beyond the basic imparting of knowledge about human rights. This presentation that I'll be giving you seeks to highlight different ideological articulations and practices of human rights education and presents examples of Indian non-governmental organizations that illustrate the argument that human rights education indeed looks different depending on who's enacting it. Data presented in this paper is drawn from 13 months of fieldwork carried out on human rights education initiatives in India that are carried out between 2008 and 2010. And is the basis of the book that Helen mentioned. While there are many variants of human rights education, there's broad agreement about certain core components of human rights education. First, most scholars, and Felisa has been instrumental in advancing a literature on human rights education, agree that human rights education must include both content and processes or pedagogy related to human rights. Second, most literature discusses the need for human rights education to include goals related to cognitive or content-related material, attitudinal or emotive values and skills, and action-oriented components that lead to some sort of activist orientation after partaking in human rights education. As human rights education spreads, it's important to mention that scholars in education have suggested that the form of HRE, or any global education reform for that matter, that gets incorporated into national textbooks and local practice may be very different than that originally conceptualized, since reforms often go through what scholars such as John Meyer and other scholars in the sociological camp call a process of decoupling. In other words, these scholars assert that by the time human rights content gets into textbooks, it may be altered such that it loses the activist-oriented approach, as human rights are presented often as decoupled from the struggles that have achieved greater respect for human rights. Indeed, these processes of adaptation can generate greater variation among human rights education initiatives. If pressure from above depoliticizes human rights, and pressure from below attempts to maintain an integral link of human rights education to social justice movements. It therefore becomes important to further unpack the different ideological bases of human rights education as the reform spreads and becomes more popular across the globe. As human rights education has been adopted and elaborated upon by more and more educational stakeholders, human rights education can no longer be characterized as a singularly understood practice. Furthermore, the varied ideological content of these programs appears to reflect where such programs locate themselves in relation to local, national, and international sites of power, not geography or nationhood understood in any simple sense. An elite private school and a marginalized indigenous community school in the same neighborhood may both offer human rights education, but their approaches may vary widely based on the material realities and conditions of each group, the manner in which human rights education is introduced, and the anticipated outcome of the learners being taught. Moving beyond nation-centered understandings of human rights, a limitation often reinforced by the organization of the UN system, helps to underscore the ways that human rights education may differ in approach, definition, and desired outcomes. I present a model, and I have a paper since I just have 15 minutes if you're interested in reading a bit more about it. I present a model that distinguishes between three broad types of human rights education. Each of these forms is not mutually exclusive with the others, but it rather offers a way to conceptualize the primary reason for the introduction of human rights education, since it generally responds to some perceived need in a particular educational system, program, or school. While the goals and objectives of human rights education can embody aspects of any of the three approaches that I'll present, my paper today argues that the ideological orientations of most human rights education initiatives are generally rooted in one of the following categories. And I'm sure we could talk about this, and there could be various ways that a program could espouse different pieces, but I've broadly put them in human rights education for global citizenship, human rights education for coexistence, and human rights education for transformative action. Human rights education for global citizenship, the first one, seeks to provide learners with membership to an international community through fostering knowledge and skills related to universal values and standards. Human rights education for coexistence focuses on the interpersonal and intergroup aspects of rights and is usually a strategy utilized where conflict emerges not from absolute deprivation but from ethnic or civil strife. This can often be seen as a strategy to get groups talking after a conflict has ensued and to humanize the other in situations of ethnic violence. The third approach, HRE for transformative action, usually involves learners who are marginalized from economic and political power and for whom human rights education includes a significant process of understanding their own realities. This approach is most akin to Paulo Freire's process of developing a critical consciousness and what Menchie's, who is a scholar who's written in the 1997 kind of Bible of human rights education, and he terms it a critical human rights consciousness. I've written, as I mentioned, more extensively if you want to look at this, but I wanted to move on and talk a little bit. A lot of scholarship on human rights education talks about the nation state as the determinant, as the UN tries to get nations, and over 100 have submitted national plans of action around human rights education. And what I argue is that in a single nation state, you might have different programs that espouse these different ideological orientations, but the nation state isn't necessarily the determinant of what's the best form of human rights education for a particular place. And what I wanted to do was highlight three organizations in India that came up through my research that exemplify each one of these different ideological models. So the first one that I wanted to talk about is called the Indian Institute of Human Rights. And its mission is to provide education in human rights through a two-year distance learning course offered as a diploma, which is an undergraduate and a postgraduate level diploma for students throughout India and increasingly throughout the globe. They've expanded beyond as well. The Institute was founded in 1999. Here's their website. And I characterize this under the global citizenship model. It was founded in 1999 and it primarily concentrates on offering human rights courses as well as organizing periodic conferences and workshops related to human rights. What's interesting about it is that it's all through distance learning and it's not through internet-based distance learning. What they do is they send 40 books to anybody who enrolls through the mail. And there are, you correspond through the mail, so it has a lot of access to people who don't even have internet access, and they noted that their students in the program oftentimes are from socioeconomic backgrounds where they don't even have access to the internet per se. Their stated goals of the two-year course are, among others, to ensure comprehensiveness of national, regional, and international perspectives related to human rights, and to examine the linkages between human rights, democracy, pluralism, development, and peace at the national and international levels. Among its students are police, military personnel, diplomats, NGO personnel, homemakers, graduate and undergraduate students, and teachers. And there was a wide variety of motivations of why someone would enroll in this two-year correspondence course. And some of it has to do with the currency that the term human rights has. And for a lot of people, having a certificate, a diploma in human rights, meant that if you're a police officer, because there's international cachet for that term, that you might get a promotion faster than someone else. Others, you know, said that it was just out of sheer interest. I heard this term, I'm interested in it. It was a fairly accessible program to partake in. It was about $400 for the 2 years, including all the books and the exams and the papers, supervision by the teachers. And if you were outside of India, which they have increasingly expanded to, it was $800 for the whole 2 years, including books and everything. They have 50,000 students who have taken this course since 1999, and 60% are working professionals, while 40% are students who may be completing other courses in other colleges concurrently. Evidence of the diverse students in the course is that they range from age 21 to 86, so quite a broad range of adult education. And I put that in the Global Citizenship Camp because the primary motivation was to kind of integrate people into this larger global community through this two-year course of understanding what these norms and standards were. I wanted to talk a little bit about the other ideological frames that I mentioned earlier, and the second one is human rights education for coexistence. And I would like to highlight one organization, and there were various working in this ideological frame, and this one is called the Center for Social Justice, which was established in 1994 to provide legal assistance to marginalized communities through representation, paralegal training, and advocacy in the state of Gujarat, which is on the west coast of India. Following the 2002 communal riots between Muslims and Hindus in Gujarat, the Center for Social Justice began carrying out a more formal school-based education for human rights program. They prefer education for human rights rather than human rights education because they feel like it's a more active term. For some human rights NGOs, school-based education for human rights emerged at this time after the riots as a way to attempt to eradicate the roots of stereotypes, hatred, and separation that they believed fueled the violence in which thousands of people were killed or injured during that time. The Education for Human Rights program of the Center for Social Justice emphasizes diversity, dignity, equality, and justice. The program operates in 110 schools in the 5th, 6th, and 7th grades. In 8 districts of Gujarat, the state of Gujarat, and aims for students to have instruction for 2 periods a week over 3 years. While the population is different in each district that the organization covers, and that modifies their approach a bit, what's common across their initiative is that it emphasizes diversity and pluralism as a core component of education for human rights and participatory methodologies of instruction. And they have teachers develop teaching and learning materials for the classroom, which is very different than conventional Indian education. They have modules which are called Rainbow. This is an image from one of the modules where they have several stories that are given that highlight gender equality, pluralism, diversity, citizenship, and peace. And this story that this picture is from, the underlying humanness of two friends who end up fighting because they're from different religious communities. One was Hindu, one was Muslim, and their underlying unity and, you know, the basic human equality is brought about through the story. There's some questions that the students have to answer about it. And several of the students and teachers that I talked to mentioned that Hindu students wouldn't go to Muslim students' houses and vice versa, but that after this instruction, even the teachers and the students would go to people of other communities' homes, they'd celebrate festivals together, and there was more mixing because of this kind of humanization of the other. The third one I wanted to talk about, and this was the organization that I spent the most amount of time with, is the Institute of Human Rights Education. And it's definitely the biggest organization working in human rights education in India. And it's the educational wing of an NGO that started as a legal and advocacy human rights monitoring organization based in Tamil Nadu. And it began, the educational piece began operating in 1997 when teachers asked activists at the organization how they might incorporate human rights principles into the classroom. They didn't know at the time that there was an ongoing UN decade for human rights education at the UN nation state level, but later on significant linkages were made. And it started as an experiment with a handful of schools. They developed a curriculum, delivered trainings for teachers, and attempted to translate their work into curricular materials that now is in 4,000 schools in 18 Indian states. They've translated the textbooks into 14 regional languages. They've trained 6,000 teachers, and 300,000 students have participated in their courses. So it's a fairly broad-based program when we look at other programs at the NGO level across the globe. The Institute of Human Rights Education's approach that I characterize as human rights education for transformative action is reflected through their reports and their textbooks and their materials, as well as through focus groups and interviews that I did throughout the 13 months that I was in India. In the 3 textbooks for their learners, which are in 6th, 7th, and 8th grades, of the 153 real-life examples, the primary curricular approach is to use real-life examples, news stories, cases from society rather than just conventions and declarations. 86.4% of them relate to social inequalities based on gender, caste, religion, income level, ability, skin color, age, place of birth. There's a huge emphasis on social inequality in their approach to human rights education. And the purpose of it is trying to place the learners who are largely from low-income, Dalit, or formerly called untouchable communities, tribal or indigenous communities, to place them in a framework where they can understand the roots of social exclusion. Of these examples, 20% present specific examples of individuals or collective action movements that have brought about social change through some type of activism. And this is part of their approach to inspire that among learners. The representative examples of human rights violations chosen for their textbooks include some graphic descriptions of caste and gender discrimination, child abuse, and social inequalities that don't usually fill the textbooks of general conventional government Indian education. But the purpose of that, they argue, is that these children are seeing it every day, and that having it in a textbook provides them a framework to understand what it is they see in the larger society and realize that they're not being bullied because something's wrong with them, but there's larger systems of social exclusion that put them in a group that's targeted. Early exposure to this abuse, to learning about abuses for learners who are positioned at the margins of society through focus groups and interviews seem to be producing this sort of, you know, critical consciousness that Paulo Freire talks about in terms of understanding larger realities and sowing the seeds for future solidarity, intervention, and activism. And some current, I have a lot of stories, happy to share other pieces of writing with you where students were indeed taking action. A group of students stopped a female infanticide that was happening in their community. Other students would get children involved in child labor, bring them back to school. There's a lot we can talk about there in terms of retaliation and the way that society may not be ready for 13-year-old kids to be doing that, but we can talk about that a little bit more maybe in the discussion. In conclusion, models of human rights education have generally focused in the literature on age, constituency, national political context, or the generation of rights to differentiate between different types of programs. This paper argues instead that ideological variation can also play a significant role in distinguishing between types of human rights education. To some, human rights education signals entry into the global community and its membership benefits, as has been discussed, for example, in Turkey's national efforts to incorporate human rights in their accession bid to the European Union. In the Gaza Strip, the United Nations Relief and Works Agency for Palestine Refugees runs a human rights education initiative to foster nonviolence, conflict resolution, and mutual understanding. In countries emerging from conflict, human rights education can embody a reconciliation strategy, often incorporated into government policy or peace accords, as has been seen in nations as diverse as Guatemala, Cambodia, Rwanda, among others. As heightened calls for evaluation are made by scholars and practitioners of human rights education, models for understanding it can offer productive frameworks for analyzing its impact, as well as the experiences of participants in programs. Distinguishing between these approaches in the categories that I've presented for global citizenship, coexistence, and transformative action is not intended in any way to diminish efforts or splinter between them. On the contrary, the mutability of human rights education, I argue, is in fact its strength. Indeed, the diversity of contexts in which human rights education can and has been implemented is indeed a testament to its relevance, adaptability, and promise as a lasting educational reform.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
from a school aligned with an armed resistance movement in Lebanon during a post-war period of sustained political violence. Focusing on the pedagogical practices at one Shia'i school, I draw on extensive ethnographic data to illustrate how teachers and students together negotiate human rights and resistance learning through a critical and participatory process at a school whose curricular content and pedagogy is infused with human rights education. They don't actually use the term themselves. However, the infusion of human rights education emerged from the analysis of my data. This human rights education includes the development of human rights knowledge and related skills and tools for praxis within a community empowerment model of education and within a larger context of local, regional, and global conflict. The research illustrates some of the challenges and opportunities for social transformation during acute and protracted conflict. My work explores teaching and learning as a complex social practice with political and socioeconomic dimensions, and considers these dimensions in relation to the basic need for human security. I take the view that empowerment is a social construct that is dynamic and multifaceted. It is also a gendered construct linked to political participation through reflection and action. Empowerment includes developing the power within the self and developing power with others for collective action. Human rights education as empowerment education addresses both direct and structural forms of violence through content and form, and interrogates power relations through a dialogical process in which students and teachers negotiate their positions and dialogue with others and with their own thinking and feeling. Thus, it allows for horizontal organization and empowers students and teachers as social agents. As a dynamic community model of schooling, the Sherry School at the focus of this paper worked concurrently on empowering the individual and the community, thus developing the agency of both relationally, using students to empower the community, using teachers to empower the students, and so on. Connecting micro and macro processes in education at a school whose community was most directly affected by the 2006 Summer War, the larger study on which this presentation is based considers how one school, through a community empowerment model of schooling, negotiated between the demands and pressures of external standards in education, the larger socio-political context, and students' academic, social, and emotional needs to carve out ideological and implementational spaces for community empowerment. Through academic engagement and through the exploration of human rights in the face of acute socio-political struggle, political violence, and devastation. I take a socio-cultural and socio-political approach to understanding how empowerment is negotiated in schools, and particularly within a community aligned with a non-state armed actor, namely Hezbollah, whose school practices are little known and little understood. I consider the ways in which schools serve to shape, monitor, and regulate discourses of empowerment and human rights. What I'm presenting here is one portion of a large-scale study that involved 10 schools from 10 different neighborhoods in Greater Beirut and over 1,000 youth participants. The research design can best be described as a vertical case study in which policy as social practice is investigated at multiple intersecting levels of analysis to understand the contradictory actions of policy stakeholders within the political and economic realities that shape their actions and struggles. What I wish to do here is to provide an illustrative example or two from the extensive classroom data I collected during the 2006-2007 academic year, directly after the war between Hezbollah and Israel, in which over 350 schools were damaged or demolished in 34 days. These schools were disproportionately Shiite educational institutions. Schools across the country sheltered displaced families, approximately 1 million displaced, as well as Iraqi refugees fleeing from another conflict. The summer was also followed by a series of politically motivated assassinations, roadside bombs, and other violent events that resulted in daily disruptions to schooling during the course of the study. For students and teachers at the Shiite school, at the focus of this presentation, this was a particularly poignant period, as many students or their larger families had lost members of their families or their homes. The school also schooled many orphans. And the students were still living in temporary housing when the school year commenced. Just a word about the Shia in Lebanon. They comprised one of 18 officially recognized religious sects, and have been generally marginalized both politically and economically for most of the nation state's history. This is particularly significant in terms of educational development when we look at the history of education in Lebanon, going back to the Ottoman period, formal schooling has a very rich and long history as various missionary and colonial sponsored minorities in Lebanon. So we had, for example, British and American missionary sponsors for the Protestant communities of Lebanon, French sponsors, educational sponsors for the Jesuit communities and Catholic communities and Maronite in Lebanon, Greek Orthodox, Greeks for the Orthodox, Russians for Russian Orthodox, and so on. So they have multiple sets. And the Ottoman Empire also began its own modern schooling to school the Sunnis of Lebanon. But the Shia were excluded from all of these educational projects. So they're largely ignored. In the sense, we can see a long history of structural violence against this community in terms of education. Their educational movement is more recent and has been gathering intensity since the close of the Lebanese Civil War in 1990, in the last 10 years. So this particular school was opened in 1997. It was opened as a girls' school by a charitable organization, and it now enrolls over 2,500 students, girls and boys, in gender-segregated classrooms. It runs both the Arabic English and Arabic French bilingual programs of the national curriculum, as well as bi-weekly religion classes and daily morning prayers. It follows a very similar model to the Christian missionary schools. It's a prevalent model for private schooling in Lebanon. It's also a university preparatory program, and students and teachers, with very few exceptions, are Shia. Although the school is open to others, in general, because of the stigma placed on this community, others do not attend Shia schools. As a dynamic community model of schooling, the Shia school both taught the national curriculum and engaged students in community-centered issues as part of its vision for personal and community empowerment and development. Teachers and administrators served as role models from the community and were also engaged in their own development and the development of the community. Within this community model, the content and form of education, including research and social action, are embedded in local struggles, and schooling emerges as a political project. Research was a key component of the school's ethic, and students and teachers were actively taught tools for inquiry, including qualitative and quantitative research methods. They did things like develop surveys and conducted interviews. And they used technologies to conduct research and to present statistics and make documentary and narrative film. Students also wrote books and displayed them alongside publishers at the annual book fair. Here we can see a display of books. And at the next table, we have publishers from around the world displaying their books. They learned public speaking, and they presented, with the support of multimedia presentations at a very large public gathering alongside officials from UNESCO at an Education for All celebration that served as a culmination of Human Rights Week. In short, they are groomed for intellectual and personal pursuits as well as for leadership and service to the community and to the nation. A word about the celebration I just mentioned. This community celebration of Education for All included hundreds of guests. It was done in a public venue so that people would feel that they could come from all over. They didn't have to have children in the school. And the secondary school students presented statistics on education and framed it in terms of human rights. And then the younger children presented plays, and a lot of these held messages to the parents who are not literate, inviting them to come back to school. The themes of these skits were things like, it's never too late to go back to school, and you can't hold me back now that I've been in school, you can never hold me back, I can be whoever I want. So these kind of messages that the children, young and old, sort of used to inspire adults to return to school were really impressive, and were done in tandem with official presentations from the ministry level and from UNESCO. So in this way, the school is both dynamic and community-centered in its conception of learning and its pursuit of empowerment and development. So I'm going to go inside the classroom now and just try to pick up two examples just to help you visualize some of the activities in the school. And this one is from an elementary classroom. It's a French class in an elementary, at an elementary level, grade two. And the teacher says to me, at the beginning of the 2006-2007 academic year, and the text is there, I worked on a writing project with students about the July War. The students were deeply hurt by the images of Israeli children writing messages to them on Israeli rockets, which were then fired into their villages during the summer. Some of you may have seen some of these images that were sent around the internet, and they're just young children writing messages on rockets. So we asked students to compose a letter in French in response, addressed to the Israeli children in these images. At first, we let them free write whatever they wanted or needed to say. After the free write, we examined the letters, which, as you can imagine, were even more terrible as a first reaction. We then engaged students in a conversation about these about their responses. We discussed how Islam and Judaism are above this and do not allow for this kind of response. We cannot allow ourselves to be dragged down by our circumstances, but rather we must rise above as our religions dictate. We then had students rewrite their letters. Most students changed their responses entirely. They were more reflective, thoughtful. As this French teacher illustrates, conflict necessitates bringing concerns about direct violence into the classroom. She cited this example to explain how she meets academic goals while engaging the French language as what she called a vehicle for trauma intervention, and at the same time, providing an opportunity for critical reflection. Drawing on religious understanding, she speaks to the sacred desire to see our own humanity through the humanity of others. This is really a measure towards restoring dignity, in my view, to the indignity that's wrought by war and devastation. In a second example, and now this is in a secondary classroom, the class has a monthly book talk in which one of the girls presents a book to her classmates and talks about the book. And so these are run by students and they're positioned in the library in the central space. So a student introduces the highlighted author, and the author is a communist. So she says, the author is a communist when proclaiming communist beliefs was illegal in the Arab world. He was imprisoned for his beliefs. The librarian then interjects, she clarifies, that the legality of communism was never questioned in Lebanon, only in other parts of the Arab world. Students now ask questions of the student presenter, and she answers confidently. The discussion proceeds in Fusha. This is an important point because Fusha is the high variety of the Arabic language, which has been critiqued as being stagnant and incompetent with sort of having these kind of critical dialogues, it's usually related to memorization. So they have this conversation in Fusha. During this book talk, students and teachers engaged in a conversation about political imprisonment in the Arab world and the significance of freedom of ideas to the well-being of civil society. Students were told that the author was a leftist who was against one-party rule of Arab regimes. Among the points of contention among the students was how the author was coerced, and later this author accepted to sign a paper rescinding his beliefs in order to end his suffering. He was tortured and he rescinded. And the students couldn't understand this. No one should ever rescind his beliefs. It was sort of the conversation that was taking place. And so this excerpt is from my field notes, and it's up here. This is the teacher. The teacher is saying to the students, you cannot jail people just for their ideas. We are free to have our political beliefs. We have to understand that just as we have our beliefs and ideas and opinions, others have theirs, and we must accept their right to have them and voice them. And from an Islamic point of view, too, to accept the other and the other's point of view. We cannot dream of a real civil society otherwise. During this complex critique of Arab states and their human rights violations, students engaged animatedly in Fusha about the principles of democracy in non-democratic states. In doing so, they reflected on the constraints that have been placed on their own beliefs and how to ensure the rights of others. Significantly, this kind of learning, in my view, assisted students in envisioning a world in which their own rights are included as part of a democratic society. Just some features, then, of this infused curriculum. The teachers integrated human rights issues across the curriculum while engaging students in constructive learning activities, motivating achievement, and providing a safe arena for discussing social and political realities and injustices. In addition, they trained students in various skills, including interviewing, providing expert testimony, and research. For example, two school-wide topics for French classes addressed women's rights in the Arab world, and women at work and at home. So for this, they interviewed high-profile women. They went to their workplaces, and they captured their testimony and wrote those up and presented that work on the walls of the school. In addition, the students conducted research on Palestinian and Iraqi women to understand how their lives have undergone change due to sustained conflict. These topics departed from the content of the national curriculum by focusing on a community-centered learning process. According to the principal of the school, the topics were also integrated in a developmentally appropriate way. So they started, for example, in the kindergarten, learning about Palestinian rights. The gravest human rights violations in Lebanon are against the Palestinians, perhaps. So they begin in the kindergarten, helping them to understand that in terms of just sort of relational things, like me and my family, them and their family. So they start with things that children can understand, and then slowly going up the grades, they start to talk about refugee issues, they take them to the camps, they begin social action projects. Thus, students are engaged as political participants in human rights learning across the curriculum through content, but also through form, such as the ways that I mentioned before, these dialogues, debates, arts, field trips. The field trips are to newspapers. They help them to imagine themselves as journalists and women in politics and so on. They also do this through skill development, the interviewing, textual analysis, documentary making, and so on, role playing. I could go on, campaigning, fundraising, and so on. So, while content and form of human rights education, the related community activism and skill development points to a dynamic community empowerment model, I do want to make one note, which is that the school structure remained vertical and very hierarchical. So this stuff was happening in class and between the school and the community. But within the actual structure of the school, there remained a strict hierarchy, from the principal to the teachers, to the parents and the students. So while horizontal organization among students and among teachers was encouraged, it was also regulated by this hierarchy. And the principal had her boss as well, right? An umbrella organization that is affiliated with a political movement. So that's important to know. This demonstrates some of the tensions and challenges to empowerment models of education. At the same time, it points to the multiple spaces and forms, as Monisha was mentioning, the multiple ways that we might actually capture human rights education. And so maybe we can discuss that more in the afterwards. Still, importantly, this case demonstrates how human rights education is central to the resilience of communities marginalized by direct and structural violence. And particularly during periods of acute conflict, in which schooling plays a key role in restoring dignity and envisioning and preparing for a world in which marginalized communities are included in a democratic society. This requires the ability to view one's own rights and one's community's rights in dialogue with others, locally, regionally, and globally.
Thank you. I only want to engage in conversation, so I'm sorry to stop this actually by presenting. But I will. I'll also read my notes for the sake of trying to keep within the 15-minute time frame. We're all sensitive to that. Human rights education has an underlying belief in the power of learning to improve the human condition. And it's a field, as we've already heard of just from the two presentations today, where one might say that practitioners have a shared mission at the most general level, which is to improve the realization of human rights, but where program audiences, content, methodologies, and even strategies for change can vary tremendously. To my mind, our understanding of the potential to use human rights standards and norms to improve the human condition will be linked to a variety of things. The first is a clear diagnosis of the human rights violations we intend to address. Secondly, identification of the rights holders and duty bearer audiences best positioned to improve the realization of human rights, either by claiming their rights or knowing and upholding their formal responsibilities to realize the rights of others. Thirdly, the identification of strategies of action that individuals can undertake in their own lives, as well as change processes they can undertake collectively in the environment around them. And finally, program design that cultivates personal agency and solidarity in order to reach these goals. So what are the conditions specifically and the teaching techniques that can help lead to transformative learning, the topic of this panel? And what are the impacts that we have seen in programs that try to meet these conditions? In my presentation today, I'm going to overview the initial results of an impact assessment I'm carrying out for a transformational, what I would call transformational human rights education program that's operating in Turkey, organized for marginalized women by an NGO called Women for Women's Human Rights. This is an independent women's NGO based in Istanbul, which developed a national human rights education program for women in order to help them to address violations of their human rights, most notably domestic physical violence, as well as emotional and economic violence. I believe that this case study helps us to understand the essential conditions for promoting transformative learning, as well as the impact, both individual and social, of participating in programs actually organized to bring about such results quite explicitly. These dimensions move us beyond an identification merely of promising practices to fundamental questions, I think, about political and social context, learners, and goals for transformation. And I do agree with Monisha, by the way, that we can't simply look at the nation state as the context for human rights education programs, but insofar as this particular program also considered legal literacy about national laws in Turkey intended to protect women, there's the one link that we did have, I think, with the national context. So, as the national context for this work is something to be considered, I'd like to lay out something of a landscape for women's conditions and legal protection in Turkey. In 2002, partly in response to pressures related to EU accession and the work of a women's rights platform in the country, very significant changes in the civil code took place. Under the old civil code, the husband enjoyed a position of absolute legal supremacy in the family, with the legally sanctioned authority to make choices over domicile, children, and property. This approach in the new civil code was abandoned in favor of one that defined the family as a union based on equal partnership. This new concept is also reflected in the language of the new civil code. The terms wife and husband, for example, were replaced by the term spouses. Moreover, the language of the code was considerably simplified, and out-of-date legalistic terminology was replaced with comprehensible modern terms, making the law more accessible to everyone. Several noteworthy changes to the code reflect the new approach to gender equality, at least on paper. First, that the husband is no longer the head of the family. Spouses are equal partners, jointly running the matrimonial union with equal decision-making. Secondly, spouses have equal rights over the family abode. Thirdly, spouses have equal rights over property acquired during marriage. Fourthly, that spouses have equal representative powers. The new civil code also raised the legal minimum age for marriage to 18. It had been 15 for women and 17 for men. Not surprisingly, despite the equality that exists in law and on paper, discrimination against women and girls continues in several areas in Turkey. A 2003 report, I know it's a bit dated, but the people I've worked with have said it's fairly, its major findings are fairly current today. A 2003 report prepared for the UN Committee Against Torture noted the following. In the eastern and southeastern regions of Turkey, over 16% of women living in the region were married under age 15. The ratio of estimated female to male earned income in the country is about half, less than half, and more than 90% of all property in Turkey is owned by men. The literacy rate for women in rural areas can be as low as 50%, and this statistic is 20% illiteracy for women if you look nationwide. Domestic violence in particular is a very grave problem in Turkey, and statistics vary on this from 40% of women throughout Turkey subjected to physical domestic violence to 90% experiencing violence at the hands of husbands and boyfriends, but there's general agreement that's a very grave problem. The discrepancy between laws on paper and customary practices is a major obstacle for many women, and this is especially the case for women of lower socioeconomic levels and women living in eastern Turkey, which is economically the least developed region and has a multi-ethnic character. This is the background against which this Women's Human Rights Group began the work in 1998. The organization Women for Women's Human Rights was established in 1996. It's actually been instrumental in forwarding the women's movement in Turkey since that time, including legislative reforms in the penal and civil code, which I just mentioned. A cornerstone of their work is a 16-week program to enable Bafferi Mesereau is a theorist who's credited with initiating the theoretical field of transformative learning. He defines transformative learning as the process by which we call into question are taken for granted frames of references to make them more inclusive, discriminating, open, and reflective, so that they may generate beliefs and opinions that will prove more true or justified to guide action. He developed the principle of perspective transformation, whereby an individual, through experience, critical reflection, and rational discourse, has a meaning structure transformation. This transformation is only rational insofar as it involves discourse and works with the conscious. Elements are also intuitive, creative, and emotional. Other iterations of Mesereau's work has been carried out. For example, Boyd has linked this with transformative learning to adult development theory. There's a scholar, Etling, who has looked at the study of praxis in relation to transformative changes in women's groups and has recognized the essential role of building bonds of friendship and support within the group in order to help claim oneself and one's beliefs. I find these theories all relevant for the work of this organization. I won't go further than to explain some of the features of, I think, sort of intentionally designed transformative learning programs for adults, and especially the program that they're doing in Turkey, which might be interesting for you. Edward Taylor has identified a few features of this kind of organized learning, which includes conditions that promote a sense of safety, openness, and trust, effective instructional methods that support a learner-centered approach and promote autonomy, participation, and collaboration, activities that encourage the exploration of alternative personal perspectives, problem posing, and critical reflection, and discussing and working through emotions and feelings before actually engaging in critical reflection. Not coincidentally, two of the four founders of the group Women for Women's Human Rights in Turkey had backgrounds in psychotherapy and had worked actually with abused women in shelter situations using group therapy in the past. This informed the modules that they incorporated into their human rights education program, as well as their understanding of the skills that trainers would need in order to successfully facilitate group processes and issues that might arise. For this reason, the group's partnership with the Turkish Department of Social Services in the country and the use of social workers as trainers is considered to be instrumental in the implementation and the success of the program. Let me speak a little bit about the methodological features of this program and now get to some of the initial results. Since its pilot application phase in the shanty towns of Istanbul in 1995-1996, The human rights education program for women has expanded to 40 cities in all regions of Turkey, and over 6,000 women have participated in the program. There's quite a bit of longevity. It's currently the most widespread and comprehensive non-formal human rights education program in the country, probably in the region. The program explores civil, economic, political, sexual, reproductive and sexual rights, gender discrimination towards children, children's rights, and violence against women within the human rights framework, with a focus on grassroots organizing and mobilization for social change throughout. Through discussing women's human rights and violations in relation to participants' personal experiences, and including workshops on communication skills, the program contends that it provides the tools to apply the critical consciousness of human rights to real life. A distinctive feature of the program is its holistic, comprehensive nature, linking several areas of human rights through a critical gender perspective lens. To do justice to this comprehensive nature, the training is conceptualized as an intensive process of over 4 months, a time frame that differentiates it from many other initiatives in human rights education. Operating in many ways as a support group, women meet weekly in this course for 3 to 4 hours, engaging in the curriculum while sharing their stories and reflections with one another. The training is based on an intensive group process. This allows women to express their experiences and needs as individuals, while acquiring a consciousness on the inherent connection between their individual experiences and human rights violations of women in general. It also enables them to share their own problems and develop strategies through the assistance and feedback of group participants, while gaining an understanding about the problems of other participants and assisting them in their search for solutions. In fact, for many women, the first step towards empowerment is the realization that the causes of their problems are not private, but social. The training includes many group exercises where women can share their individual painful experiences of violations of their human rights, discrimination, and violence. And the group process enables them to realize that these experiences are not an inescapable part of her individual destiny or a result of her failures, but rather a collective experience shared by many other women as a result of a socio-political system leading to human rights violations of women. So, now to the study. In 2002, an external evaluation of the program was conducted to evaluate its overall impact. Aiming to review the program from a broad perspective, to identify successes and problem areas, and to provide insight for future implementation. I'm now completing a second external evaluation of the program for the time frame of the last 5 years. This methodology has included the administration of surveys to a stratified sample of former participants, as well as to all the trainers, focus group discussions with trainers, interviews with key informants, including Women's for Women's Human Rights staff and partner organizations, and case studies of two human rights groups involving observations and interviews with a few of the participants and the trainer at the beginning and the end of the training program. And last week I was doing the last round of data collection as the they're called KEHEP groups. The KEHEP groups that started in January, we're just wrapping up last week. Of the 126 trainers associated with the program, 88 of them completed a questionnaire, and of the stratified random sample of around over 500 alumni that we had identified for the participation over the last 5 years, we had a return rate of about 40% for the surveys, or 247. So the combination, I think, of the qualitative research and the survey data we have filled with us a good view of the impacts that, perhaps best case, but nevertheless impacts that women and trainers have experienced in this program. I wanted to also look at impacts on the trainers because I speculated on, you know, obviously it's kind of clear that if you're a trainer in this program, you also have a story to tell around your engagement with these issues and the experiences of learning while working with these women over time. So I'd like to share just today the overall results of the participant questionnaire. The forthcoming statistical work is going to be looking at, to really explore impacts related to the passing of time, if there's any relationship between impacts, for example, and poverty level, I'd like to see if there's impacts between specific outcomes and specific conditions associated with poverty, such as low educational levels in large households. So stay tuned for the final results. And here's some of just the results. This is a really long quote. I'm not going to read to you. This is in case you get bored with my presentation. See, and I didn't want to break up this quote because it's such a beautiful quote, and it so includes, I think it encapsulates so many of the outcomes we saw. When I developed the survey that was administered to participants, I had many benefits. The first is that I had the benefit of being able to refer to the survey that was administered and the impact assessment that was carried out in 2004. And I could look at that survey, and I decided to include specific questions so I could make comparisons now, 5 years later, and I will. But I also felt that there were elements that the survey hadn't included that would be important to capture. And I was especially interested in some of the more psychosocial elements of personal agency that hadn't been quite captured. And I also wanted to, and any of my students in this room know, because I assigned this reading, we discussed it, I also wanted to include questions that would try to capture results that might be not as positive, because change processes are not so simple. And anyone who is marginalized or living in situations of ongoing repression or oppression have, if you try to change power relations or find ways of changing how you are relating to family members or work cohorts, it's not so simple. There might well be struggles involved, and maybe not easy ones to negotiate. So that being said, I'm going to just report some of the results here. I did the classic sort of separation between knowledge, attitudes that I'm actually really presenting, and behaviors. But what I actually found, and I want to explore a bit more, is that there's a whole area of feelings that really didn't fall into the category of attitudes or knowledge. And I found that, I quoted the open-ended responses, and I'm not reporting on that today, but the open-ended responses, which complement some of the survey results I'm going to share, to me, showed which elements of these impacts the women valued most. Because I have a very long list of potential outcomes that I'll show you some results of for these participants. But I also asked in the open-ended questions, I asked women to write to me, and also in the interviews I did, what was the most significant change for them that they would report? I mean, of all the changes, which do they value most? And it was very interesting to see which ones the women valued most. And for a very large majority of women, these had to do with the elements of feelings, of self-confidence, and valuing themselves more. And so I felt this is something I really want to explore a bit more in terms of human rights education. And I guess that's all I can say right now, but I have a little more at it. In terms of knowledge, this actually was a very big gain. You can see here, I hope you can read it well enough, there were legal literacy, that was the origins of this program back in 1998 was as a legal literacy program. That's exactly what they called it, actually. And so at that time, the civil code and the penal code had not actually been reformed. And now, of course, it's a different matter. So this is an opportunity for women to learn not only about women's rights, but actually the protections afforded to them by now the criminal code and the civil code. So let me get you actually the specific questions. I just have these. So the first question that the my participation in the training program has increased my understanding of women's rights perspectives. You can see there's over 80% of the women. You can see that a lot is the gold and then little in the middle. You really have a really high, very strong effects in terms of understanding women's rights perspectives, Turkish legal documents that protect women's rights in Turkey, and protect rights. These are actually government agencies in Turkey and civil society organizations that are protecting women's rights. Huge knowledge gains around very, very practical, I can say, legal documents and institutions intended to protect women's rights. So that's not surprising, and nevertheless, it's good to see it documented. And this came up a lot for women. And as an aside, by the way, this is regardless of women's educational background. I mean, women also who, in some cases, they have college educations, or even social workers sitting in on these programs report similar gains. It's amazing, actually, how little can be understood in the public domain around these kinds of documents intended to protect rights. And even when they're not even international documents, but national documents, in this case in Turkey.
Here's an example of a quote, because of course I have to have some quotes, right? Mm-hmm. Knowing that I'm a woman and that there were laws and justice for me too, knowing where I can apply and get help if I run into trouble, I can't write down or explain all the things I've learned from the human rights education program, as there's no end to it. Before I participated in the program, I used to say, one should be born a man into this world. But I say that no more. I say, fortunately, I'm a woman. Effective changes in participants. This is more along the idea of feelings. So the questions here, I identified the ones related to solidarity, self-confidence, valuing the self, and actually courage. I thought courage. Courage, I think, is a really important feature to recognize around human rights education and its impact on individuals. And I think empathy and courage are two really dimensions I'd like to explore more in the future in my work. So, but let me tell you the questions and exactly how they were phrased. These trainings make me feel in solidarity with other women. These trainings increased my overall self-confidence. These trainings made me feel more courageous. These trainings made me value myself more. And you can see that there's quite a bit of impact around these areas. Maybe if you, depending on whether you feel it, you should just be looking at a lot or a lot and a little, you know, you might say it's almost unanimous that there are changes to some degree. But it's really, these were really quite strong results. And again, we're not talking about a 2-hour workshop or even a 1-day workshop. We are talking about a 14-week program. It's really a long program. It's a lot of contact hours. So, and here's an example of a quote. I learned what solidarity and unity is. I realized that everything is much more beautiful and exciting when we act in unity and share things together. And I wanted to take this quote out, but lots of quotes on increased self-confidence and valuing of self. But again, one of the human rights education dimensions is the idea of taking action, and in particular, collective action. And that they're not antithetical, of course, at all. And although we've seen in this study, and I'm not going to get into it, that there were not so many women that ended up politically organizing, but there, the women nevertheless, in addition to making changes in their personal relationships in many cases, they did become more engaged in women's issues in general, serve as a resource person for other women, much more sort of informal kinds of promotion of women's rights and new ways of thinking about relationships. But nevertheless, so the solidarity and unity is very much an interpersonal one, woman to woman. But at the same time, it leads one to think about collective action, and there certainly were women that proceeded in that way in terms of getting engaged in women's rights in Turkey. Skill changes are also fairly evident, you can see. I have the percentages here, but the colors will speak for themselves. Skill changes related to their ability to express themselves, to make decisions, to solve their problems, and also to help others solve their problems. The ability to express my thoughts more was a very, very fundamental change. Of the skills dimensions, this was the most pronounced change for women. And there are 2 weeks of the 14 where they actually focus on communication skills. And it was really revelatory for many women. It was amazing. Because I had, for example, imagined before I started to watch these groups that when they spoke about expressing themselves, that there had perhaps been an inhibition of their being able to express themselves, and this may have resulted in a kind of continuation of their, if you will, their oppression in their family, if this was their situation. But rather, for many women, they had been expressing themselves, but it was their relations were rife with conflict because they there was not a real dialogue. So this ability to express oneself is not just being able to express one's true desires or needs and to recognize what those might be, which in some cases shifted, I think, in these trainings, but also to be able to engage constructively in conversations with husbands and perhaps with children. So this is more complex than simply just self-expression. But anyway, skill changes related to these kinds of skills. I guess in the interest of time, I'll just move forward rather than to just read the exact questions. But here's an example of someone who did learn, I think, to express themselves better. Previously, I wasn't able to express my feelings, but now I can explain myself. I used not to talk about anything, as I thought no one would understand me. But that's no longer the case. And the best is now I trust and love myself. The final area of outcomes I'm looking at is behavior, which of course is always the sort of the
the most elusive, if you will, question to answer. What changes do really results from engagement in human rights education programming? And one of the outcomes from the 2004 study, which was very telling, was that there was evidence that women did make changes in their lives. And I will be comparing the outcomes of this group with the group from 2004. But I will say that we had some very concrete results reported by this group of women. Again, methodologically, maybe these are the best case because they are the 40% of the sample that we sent out, they came back. So perhaps these are the women for whom the training is most effective. This is something I'll probably, of course, I'll put in the report. But nevertheless, these are very important figures to note in any case. In terms of behavioral changes, 35% of the women completing the survey reported that as a result of the training, they restarted or continued their education. In terms of returning to work, we had 26%, that's the figure, you can't quite see it, but 26% ended up going back to work or starting work as a result of the program, which is considered a gain in this program because some women were basically at home and not able to go out, allowed to go out, and this was for them a sign of independence. And there's different ways to interpret it, but these women interpreted it as positive. And involvement in the women's movement, this is more general. The question was contributed to, let me see what this one is, women's movement. Contributed to my becoming more involved in the women's movement in Turkey, for example, organizing seminars or participating in petitions. That was about 43%. So you see a high level of behavioral engagement here that's quite telling. After this training that I've taken, I realized that even at the most impossible times when I feel totally hopeless, there are options other than sitting around and crying. I took my first step to this end by going back to my schooling. Hopefully my life will be different when I graduate. And again, I'm just giving you some examples, but this program has been going on for 10 years, and this is really the kinds of results we've seen over time. So it's not sort of exceptional cases. This is, I think, very typical for the kinds of responses we have had, for example, went back to school. I do want to show some counterexamples or some alternative examples. One of the areas also of change had to do with how women began to think about how they were raising their children. I have another section here on family relations. I probably will organize it differently the next time I present this in my report. But there was a change of women, many women reported that they became more sensitive to gender roles in raising their children. That was, in fact, we had about 65% of those who had children reporting quite substantial impacts on how they raised children. The majority of women view themselves as house resource people for women in their community, meaning by that they basically informally share information and advice about women's rights with their friends and other members of the community. At the same time, we see not such high figures in terms of women becoming actually involved in women's organizations and politically active. This is actually a kind of a question and concern for the women in Istanbul. Why aren't women getting more politically active? And there's still wonders about why that's the case. And actually, as an aside, one of the speculations is that the trainers, who are social workers, are not as much oriented towards political organizing. But a subset of the trainers are from women's NGOs, and those women graduating from those programs are much more likely to start their own women's organization or get involved in grassroots organizing. So some of it has to do with the features of, I think, of the trainers. Family relations is a really interesting domain to think about because when we think about domestic violence and the origins of this whole training program, it was originally intended to address domestic violence. So we asked a number of questions related to what happened in family relations after the training. And here we have outcomes related to influences. This one question was that they had, what asked whether they had more influence in family decisions that took place. And you can see that there is more influence in family decisions. At the same time, I asked directly if there was increased conflict in the family. And we saw that there was, for most of them, no, but there was some increased conflict. And I did have some discussion about why that was the case, which we could discuss afterwards. We had generally improved relationships in the family, even if there was conflict, overall more improvement. And you can see some husbands got more involved in housework, which is in here or something. So
This is my last slide, because this is also an area of special interest. The question was then, in terms of violence, what kind of changes did we see? Although only a very small amount of the women who completed this survey, 14% indicated that they experienced physical violence before the trainings. For those that did experience it, the vast majority decreased or ended. And that was a clear result. Similarly, emotional violence, economic violence, you can see the statistics there. There were very strong indications that these situations improved. And yet for a subset of women, of course, it didn't improve. It remained the same, and a very small number even increased. And this is the real messiness of human rights education programming when you're having to deal with family relations. So I mean, thank you for that extra time.
Members of the panel had a conversation with each other before we opened up to the general audience, but I think in fact we'll basically open up to questions. I only have one or two very good comments about it. I'm not going to say a huge amount of discussing it, but the thing that's so striking about this, and I think each of you put it up, is the kind of model which comes and is reflected in Ferreri's work and Duncan's as well. The vital importance of practice accompanied by self-reflection, accompanied by mutual support in the community. Knowledge by itself doesn't do an awful lot, but knowledge coming out of self-discovery and reflection seems to be a consequence of this type of program. And that's an important message to take away from all areas of social participation, of human rights education, and general political empowerment. I think that's the message, a very brief message, that one is hearing from this, and it's an encouraging message. But it's a bit more complicated than going to a classroom and teaching people simply the cognitive aspects of it. The floor is yours, so who'd like to start off the talk? If there is a microphone, if you want to speak, I think we can all be heard here. If you put your hand up and ask a question, would you please say who you are? Yes.
Hi, my name is Orla Penning. I work at the School of Public Health and the Ethics Research and Human Rights. I just had a question from Manisha and Zina as well. The kind of impact of human rights education, if the political sphere, how it kind of infiltrates that. I mean, you were saying that school was kind of run by or influenced by Hezbollah, and equally in Gujarat, that NGO, I think it's an NGO that does the human rights education. If they teach it in government schools, I'm presuming that there has to be, if it's by teachers, there has to be some, you know, government state influence there. And I'm just wondering how they interact, and these seem obviously both very positive examples, but if there can be some, I don't know, tension there.
I'll just be brief. The program that I talked about, THIRD, which is in 18 states, which is a more broad-based program, they call it human rights education, and there's quite a few educational reforms in India that are using the language of human rights. The most recent Right to Education Act that makes education compulsory. There's a lot of human rights education. A few years ago, there was a Right to Information Act that made government documents, kind of like the Freedom of Information Act of the United States, made government have to release documents if somebody were to ask for it. So there's a lot of human rights language circulating nationally. So using that term for the education, what actually happens when kids start getting active is what Felisa referred to right here, which is there's sometimes some forms of retaliation, backlash, that happen, especially in rural settings, when kids most around caste start upsetting norms that might result in some backlash from the community. In the state of Gujarat, that example that I gave, there is a more kind of conservative government in place, one that was also in power at the time of the riot, so there is a little more delicateness that has to be done, and they don't actually call it, they call it education for human rights internally, but in the schools they call it diversity education when they operate in government schools. So there is that kind of wording that goes on, and I think getting into those schools, it has been a process of working through sympathetic officials who've been allowing them to go in. They use donor funding, but they need permission from the schools since they are government schools. So there's kind of a delicate dance that does happen there, and there is the threat at any moment that the government will say, oh, what you're teaching we don't really want. But so far, for the last few years, they've been able to operate it without too much, with the focus on the rainbow, with diversity and pluralism, and then kind of bringing in through that frame. In other states, it's not as tricky.
Sure, I mean, the political sphere infiltrates on all levels. I mean, the school sees itself as engaged in a political project. They don't shy from that. So in themselves, they are a political project. But also, the political sphere interacts through the national curriculum. So that we're talking about the state. This is an opposition group to the state, but it's still teaching the national curriculum in addition to these other bits and pieces. But the national curriculum also includes some overlapping themes. What happens in the classroom is that they extend those themes to relate them to the community itself. So while the textbook may have related themes in it, perhaps it's in a language textbook or something else, they will then extend those to events that are taking place for the community itself. There is pushback also from the larger community. So there are conservative forces within the larger community that also push back on the school. This kind of critical and participatory learning that this human rights education is taking place in is not always, you know, totally welcome. So they do push back, and the principal also pushes them back. She's a very high authority figure. So she's backed by a spiritual leader, and so that gives her a lot of power to push back also. But the teachers also navigate the sphere. They are very clear about the political situation, and they know which students come. You know, this one comes from a family, perhaps with a martyred parent. This one comes from a family. They know the families. This one, you know, her brother is perhaps carries arms, or, you know, is actually engaged with Hezbollah. So they navigate that in order for the students to understand the differences between them. I think that this is quite tricky for all teachers to do. Most teachers don't know their students that well, or the communities that they come from. The other thing is that, of course, the political sphere constrains students' actions in the future. They will face discrimination. It's a fact. They know it. They've already seen their older siblings face it in society. We're talking about a community who, just in my parents' generation, they used to joke and say, oh yeah, those people have tails. And, I mean, we're talking about, you know, it's kind of like the low caste setup, but not everybody in Lebanon is even aware of that. That's what's so crazy about it. So yes, I think it does infiltrate. And then you have to think about just the reality of repeated conflict, the loss of homes and so on, that these students have a hard time envisioning that world where they will be equal participants, who will not lose their homes and who will not live in fear. I mean, at least during the time of the study, those were some of the issues that came up.
Good question, Adam.
Andrew Conning, I'm RA for CMEI, second year doctoral student here. Your talks were kind of stimulated some thoughts about spreading the ideas of human rights and universal rights through professions. So Zina, you just talked about the authority of the principal in the school, and Monisha, you were talking about in your presentation about how, I guess you said in India, there are security or police groups that see this kind of international cachet in having a human rights certification. It seems to me that that's, you know, a really powerful lever to use around the world, is to kind of work through the professions and their kind of international legitimation process. And I know that that has been, a lot of work has been done on human rights education, basically making the argument that education is a profession that's kind of globally legitimated, and so educators in different countries feel like they need to have credentials that have value in their home countries. And if human rights is just part of the recipe for education, internationally, then that's going to get replicated. So it makes me think a little bit about, and especially Monisha's comment about how that can actually have an impact on a police force, And you know, you think of police and military as being kind of immune to international pressure. They're kind of the sovereignty bodies par excellence. But maybe is there some way to work through the professions so that I mean, I know we don't think of the U.S. military as being a high representative of human rights, but they have, you know, created these ideas about the professional military respecting human rights and are trying to train other militaries. So I don't know, is there something we can think about in terms of maybe directly trying to professionalize security and military forces and encouraging them to have the idea of human rights as kind of part of their professional qualification?
To do exactly that. The actors that are usually outside of the countries facilitating that would be the international governmental organizations, regional human rights institutions. So the UN is actively engaged, the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, working with governments interested to integrate human rights into the training of military and law enforcement officials. The guidelines, methodological training manuals have been elaborated on exactly that. Quite detailed for actually for the police. So on the one hand, there actually have been elaborated guidelines for that, and the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights and the UN in general has promoted the infusion of human rights in the training of law enforcement officials. Actually, the second phase of the World Program for Human Rights Education highlights that group as a target group for the next 4 years in particular. How those changes happen, I find it a little bit unusual to think of individual police officers interested to sort of lift up and be credentialed in human rights. I think that's kind of the first time I've heard that. More frequently I hear about trainings coming in or through high-level contacts with, say, the UN or the OSCE if you're working in Europe, or alternatively, because my organization has done some police trainings, if there's a problem. Police units have been accused of discriminatory practices and the problem is to be solved, then you might bring in someone to help you fix yourselves, if you will, and reform codes of conduct and have trainings with folks so that human rights norms may come in through, you know, be integrated into codes of conduct for police, use of arms and so forth. So it's definitely happening, it's not neglected, and I think it's happening more than it used to happen. But I have to say, I haven't heard of it really before where individual police officers taking
the test. Yeah, it wasn't widespread. I would say these were kind of examples of individuals who caught on to human rights as something that could help them advance their career. And they, you know, it was a low-cost program where they could do it at home and send in, you know, their papers through the post. And so I wouldn't say I don't know what the percentage of those 50,000 participants, I would say a very small percentage is actually probably police officers, and they might be ones who are higher ranked where it would make a difference that they could get promoted to even higher ranks if they had some knowledge. Because I'm in education and I focus mostly on formal schooling, I haven't been as involved in these kind of professional education focused on human rights, but just anecdotally I can say that I think discursively and in the discourse of human rights there's a lot going on. Previously, prior to getting into academia, I worked at Human Rights Watch, and we would have sometimes military generals come and they would talk with people at Human Rights Watch. And, you know, there was this kind of, this is what we have to do now in this era of human rights, is have this as part of military and police. And in other countries, I've given talks to military generals and around human rights. But I wonder if that's just that 1 hour, that one day, and then business as usual. So is it really a transformative approach to human rights education, or is it on the curriculum, there's 1 hour, and then people, you know, tune back and do every, you know, does it infuse the entire curriculum of the professional training, or is it one thing that then people can defend themselves if they see we have human rights, which, you know, it's all fine now. So I would really encourage that kind of a deeper engagement with understanding what does it mean to really take up human rights, and does it transform the curriculum and approach in some way that the individuals that those professionals are interacting with really see a benefit to their rights being respected.
Yes. My question, I was very inspired by the Turkish study, and really nice to see the slides on family behavior and family violence to see that, and I guess I didn't expect it, So it leads me to my question, two questions. The first part is there anything within the training or within the curriculum itself where women are, or men are engaged in the process, and men being marginalized? Which leads me to the second question. When I started in field education, I was very involved in issues around race and equity in the United States, and worked a lot with material Peggy McIntosh on black privilege. And I've often wondered in issues of gender education in relation to human rights, where is the role of educating the boys and men, and how? And I know that it's very difficult for buy-in, but I've often wondered, because women are the only, but they're second to humanity that actually live in close association with their oppressors, intimate association. And I've often wondered, you know, where is that role in human rights education?
So briefly, there are two questions that are great questions. The first one I can answer in the context of the program itself. They do not involve men directly in the program. They want to keep a safe space for women to be able to share their problems and experiences, and they feel that keeping it only for women is really essential for that safe space. They have had requests to work with men separately, and they often refer other organizations to do that, because there are other NGOs in Turkey working on issues of gender and equality and involved men. So they don't feel like it's their sole responsibility. I was interested also in this issue of violence, and what the social workers told me, because I also expected to see higher indications of violence, is that because they are social workers, it's like an early warning signal. If there is, when a woman comes in and she doesn't come back, for example, they check, they call, why, or did you come back? If there's something comes in the family, because they're social workers, they can bring the husband in, they can have a session. So part of it is dealing with these problems outside of the sessions, which is another real strong reason to have social workers training. In terms of the larger issue of gender equality, which just changed, I mean, this is a huge topic, a really interesting one, and this particular women's group has taken a position that they're not working with men. But I think that in my own experience, and I invite other people on the panel to discuss as well, that dialogue is really important. The issue is gender, it's not just women's human rights. So, but this organization is approaching it this way because of their genesis and the ways they decided to work with women and to, before the women's movement was a women's movement, basically, in Turkey. And I think that they're really, that's their history and that's how they are. But I agree with you that to have that dialogue and that mutual discussion around gender role is very important.
The organization that I spent the most amount of time with, I was in six states, with the one that's based in the South but is in 18 states. So I looked at six states' children's experiences with human rights, teachers' experiences. And I did an analysis of the textbooks. And the first most talked about issue across the 3 years where they gave instruction 2 hours a week for 3 entire years and they have textbooks, the first one was poverty and inequality and kind of development issues. The second topic across the 3 textbooks, the first year was on human rights, the second year children's rights, the third year discrimination. None of them were called gender or women's rights, but the second most talked about issue across the 3 textbooks was gender and women's rights, from issues of dowry, infanticide, feticide, domestic violence. And what I found in talking to the kids is that even when I didn't ask about women's rights or gender to the girls or boys, it came up quite a bit. So a 7th grade student said, for example, after learning about this, I took my plate and washed it myself, even though my sister always used to do that for me. Or I argued that she should be able to come out and play, and we have equal tasks at home. So the boys became really important advocates for their sisters as well, or the girls in the community, because they had a little more power. I heard stories of secondary students saying, you know, my sister, with her marriage was being arranged, she was 16, she wanted to keep studying, I convinced my parents to let her go to school and finish, and then, you know, so these kinds of negotiations that took place. The girls were also able to do certain things, but with a bit more backlash. For the teachers as well, I talked to teachers who said, I stopped feeding my wife after going to human rights education trainings. Female teachers saying, after teaching this to the kids, I realized that what was happening at home, you know, domestic violence was wrong, and I told my husband, look at this book, I'm not going to take this anymore. So these kinds of things came out in a lot of the trainings as well.
Yes, hi. My name is Padmaja, and I'm at school and interested in the English to human rights and peace education. So I'm really very heartened to hear the response to the last comment that you mentioned, how there is BSA is being contagious. So across the board, I've been thinking about it. All the presentations were really great and just very moving. What is your feeling of, you know, teacher participation, teacher training? Is it happening at a more
systematic level, or at this point it's only people who opt into these trainings? And what is your vision for it in the future moving forward? How can it be integrated with the teachers' colleges as part of their training, that everybody gets at least some basic level of education about human rights and respecting cultural diversity, gender diversity, class, which is all, and which is also kind of related to each place, of, each location in the country, I think. And my second question is, I was really very interested with the point you brought up about psychosocial impact. And I'm still not clear, you know. I come from India, and there is a very negative connotation towards therapy or anything emotional discussions bringing it into the public forum. I left India 10 years ago, so I don't know how the situation now is, but other than a group that is only for women, I don't think this gets discussed in a very in a horsey fashion where people have access to places or tools to discuss this, handle their emotions. How do you envision it? Like, what is your experience of connecting on these different things?
Sure. So I'll address your first question. Human rights education is not part of any kind of systematic training in Lebanon. I would very much like to see it become so, and I think that's part of my work going forward. In relation to the teachers of this particular school, they've been trained in different places. Some of them not even in Lebanon. Some of them have been trained in Syria, for example. However, the school has a vision for professional development. They have a vision of progress, actually, and it's for everybody. It's for the parents, it's for the teachers, it's for the students. And so professional development is a very important part of their idea of lifelong learning. So they work with the teachers a lot, and that's where we see some of this stuff coming in. That's also just, it's just lived experience. They know human rights. Or they know the absence of rights, perhaps. That makes it easy to connect these texts with texts of people around the world. They do a lot of work on, for example, Native American issues or African American. You know, they connect with other peoples. So I think
really in solidarity.
Yes. Yes.
Sure. I would say part of my book that and part of my study was to look at policy initiatives as well. And I didn't find any rigorous emphasis on human rights in any. You know, sometimes it was a code word or a word, a buzzword that was used in teacher policy documents for teacher education, or it was kind of couched in children's rights or something, but I didn't see a lot of curriculum around it. This NGO program, they get permission from the government to, through the state governments where most education in India is implemented through. And then through that, the schools will say, okay, we have to do this program, and either the headmaster will assign the youngest teacher or the least favorite teacher to go to this training because it's an extra burden, or if someone's interested, they'll go to the training. And the trainings are usually in, you know, nice surroundings, a retreat area, and they generally reported liking it and getting involved afterwards. But for the most part, it's not incorporated thoroughly in any way, and I do think it should be to a greater degree. Problem is, it's not a subject that appears on the exam. So there's a lot of emphasis on what's nationally examined at the 10th and 12th grade levels, as you know, in India, where the high stakes exams take place. So until it becomes part of what is considered, you know, legitimate knowledge, it's difficult for teachers and teacher education to really take it seriously. I think, you know, it's tricky. Do you put everything on the exam so then people take it seriously, or does that take away from, you know, this kind of living and breathing knowledge of human rights that doesn't, you know, it's hard to assess it on an exam, you know, who wrote the UDHR or what year did it, you know. You end up going for facts that really have little to do with what human rights should mean in people's lives. So it gets a little tricky. With teachers in India, what I found across schools is that oftentimes teachers were the ones in the human rights, involved in human rights violations. So, you know, extracting bribes from the kids, not showing up. The average teacher absentee rate in India is 25%, bribing officials so that they can still get their salary. So reforming teachers, is, I think, should be a key priority in terms of having them
humanize the oftentimes lower class, lower caste kids that they are teaching to. Teachers are a middle class profession in India. Most of them send their kids to private schools. So in government schools, I think bringing human rights in through process, content, structure should be a priority, but it's not there yet.
I'm going to give Felice an answer at 3:00 or 4:00, and I would have to go at that time, so you're welcome.
I agree with everything that Zina and Monisha have said in regards to teacher education, but I just want to problematize one element of it, which is that this comes up a bit when we think about curriculum reform. Should you set the subject across curriculum, and then how do you prepare teachers for this? And I think it's not as simple as even preparing teachers. Just a few weeks ago, I spoke with someone who works in the Ukraine, and they have a whole separate subject in cross-curricular. And there are advocates for human rights education that believe not every teacher should teach it, because if they don't feel it, it's something that's just on paper, it's in their sort of ideology, and it's counterproductive. So one can think about that very carefully. If we ever have a teacher education program widespread enough that would prepare all teachers for this, or do we accept that we provide opportunities in the curriculum somehow, whether it's exams or not, for teachers who are motivated to do so, and to be well prepared for that. So I think we have a question here about who would be best prepared to teach this, and that might lead us not to have human rights education widespread in schools.
And that's the universal question, I think, not just the country you vote for.
I want to thank our wonderful panel for extremely stimulating thoughts.
I'm sure if you want to stick around for a while and talk informally, this will be available. But thank you all for coming, and thank you for your useful questions. We'll all be very inspired.
Thank you so much.